Assalamu alaikum. This is Dr. Rania Sayyad. Now we will talk about descending tracts, basal ganglia, white matter of the brain. Our objective today, we will talk about pyramidal tracts. We should know origin, course, and termination. Extrapyramidal tracts, we will talk about the basal ganglia. You should know what is the basal ganglia, what its component, relations, and blood supply. And finally, we will talk about the white matters of the cerebrum. We classified it into association, commissural, and the projecting fiber. And we will talk about the corpus callosum, which is the most commissural fibers, and the internal capsule, which is the most projecting fibers. First, what are pyramidal tracts? Pyramidal tracts include two components. The first is corticospinal tract, and second is corticopulbar. Corticospinal, from its name, it connects the cortex with the spinal cord, Why the corticopulbar tract connects the cortex with the brain stem, with the nuclei of the cranial nerves present in the brain stem? The pyramidal tract is one of the descending tracts. You know, in the physiology, the tracts are ascending, carry sensations, and descending, carry motor information. So the motor tracts are descending tracts. The motor tracts include pyramidal and extrapyramidal. The pyramidal tracts include corticospinal and corticopulbar. The corticospinal tract is concerned with the movement of the muscle supplied by the spinal nerves, while the corticopulbar tract is concerned with the muscle supplied by the cranial nerves. Okay? Now, what is the pathway of the corticospinal tract? As we said before, we have in the cortex, we have primary motor area 4, in the frontal loop. In front of it, motor area 6. Okay, behind of the motor area 4, this is the general sensory area, area 3, 2, 1. Okay, 3, 1, 2. So this cortex or these areas give origin to the pyramidal tract. So the pyramidal tract receives beginning or receive its origin from the motor cortex, which are motor area 4 for initiation of movement, motor area 6 for modulation of movement, and the general sensory area for perception or control, sensory control of movement. All these areas give origin to the pyramidal tract, so the pyramidal tract present in the cortex. It's then descending downward in the internal capsule, in the posterior lamb of the internal capsule. We will discuss the internal capsule at the last of the lecture. Then descending downward in the brain stem. As it descends in the brain stem, it will pass anteriorly. It will pass in the crest cerebri of the midbrain. Okay. Then in the ventral part of the bones, then in the ventral part of the medulla, forming the pyramid. The pyramid of the medulla lies ventrally and in the midline, near the midline. Okay. At the lower medulla, the pyramidal tract will divide into 80% of fibers. Cross to the opposite side, like this. This is the pyramidal tract descending in the internal capsule, then through the ventral part of the brain stem to reach the lower medulla. In the lower medulla, the pyramidal tract, most of fibers, about 80% of fibers of the pyramidal tract, decussate or cross to the opposite side. Okay? And descend like this in the spinal cord. Descend in the lateral funiculus or lateral column of the spinal cord, forming what is called lateral corticospinal tract. Okay, this is the lateral corticospinal tract. the rest of fibers, which doesn't cross to the opposite side, about 80 or 50% of fibers, descending downward near the midline in the anterior column of the spinal cord. So they are called anterior or ventral corticospinal tracts. Okay? These tracts end downward in the gray matter, the anterior horn, in the anterior horn of the spinal cord, in the gray matter of the anterior horn of the spinal cord, to reach its effector organs in the muscle spindle or in the muscle. Okay? So the pyramidal tracts, their origin originate here in the cortex. They receive origin from the motor cortex, motor area 3, about 30% of fibers, premotor area 6, about 30% of fibers, and about 40% originating in the parietal lobe from the primary sensory area. The fibers collecting together to form one tract, which is called the pyramidal tract. The pyramidal tract descending downward in the internal capsule, then continue downward to buses in the ventral part or the anterior part of the brainstem, like this, in the crest cerebri, basis pontus, or ventral part of the pons, like here in the ventral part of the medulla, forming what is called pyramid. Decastations occur in the lower part of the medulla. Most of fibers decastate to the opposite side, forming the lateral corticospinal tract. Lateral corticospinal tract, which end in the gray matter or in the anterior horn of the spinal cord. The rest of fibers, which doesn't decastate, continue downward in the near the midline, forming the ventral or anterior corticospinal tract. Note that this is the level of decastation of fibers. Any lesion above the decastation, that means cortical lesion, internal capsule lesion in the brainstem, causing injury or paralysis on the opposite side, causing contralateral plegia, okay? But any lesion below the decastation, any lesion in the spinal cord or in the nerves or in the anterior gray matter, cause paralysis on the same side of the lesion, okay? Causing the paralysis of the opposite side of the lesion. Again, the cortex or the internal capsule, okay, or the fibers in the brainstem, these fibers decastate here. So they control the opposite side of the body. So any lesion in the cortex or in the internal capsule or higher up in the brainstem, this is caused affection of the opposite side as the fibers cross, okay? While any lesion after crossing of the fibers, it causes paralysis of the same side of the lesion. So again, the pyramidal tract's origin, about 30% of the fibers originate from the motor area, primary motor area 4, about 30% originate from the motor area 6, about 40% of fibers originate from the somatosensory area or general sensory area 3, 1, 2. The fibers starting from the sensory cortex influence the sensory input to the central nervous system. Means that the fibers or the sensory area modulate the movement. Okay? Another origin of fibers from the occipital, temporal, and parietal lobes also give small origin to the pyramidal tracts for more modulation of movement. What is the best way? As we said, the fibers pass in the posterior lamb of the internal capsule. Okay, they enter the crest cerebri, the ventral part of the midbrain. They descend downward through the ventral part of the pons, then the pyramids of the upper part of the medulla. Okay, near the lower part of the medulla, most of fibers, about 80% of fibers, cross the opposite side, decastate to the opposite side, forming the pyramidal decastation, okay? And lower than the lower medulla, they pass in the lateral column or lateral funiculus of the spinal cord, forming the lateral corticospinal tract, okay? The fibers of the corticospinal tract end in the anterior horn of the gray matter of the spinal cord. Other fibers which doesn't decastate or doesn't cross the midline, continue downward anteriorly and form the anterior or ventral corticospinal tract. Okay. On reaching the appropriate level of the spinal cord, this fiber, which doesn't cross at the medulla, may cross at the spinal cord. Okay. Many of these fibers cross to the opposite side, and the remaining very small amount of fibers which doesn't cross to control or to bilateral represent the trunk. Now we talk about the pyramidal tracts. What are about the extra pyramidal tracts? I want to know that tract means it is a group of fibers, okay, that collected together. Group of fibers collected together has the same origin, the same course, and the same termination. This is what I mean by tract. So tract is a group of fibers, okay, has the same origin, the same course, and the same termination. So we call the pyramidal tract is a tract as it originating from the same areas in the cortex, having the same course and end, the same end. The extra pyramidal tracts, these are tracts that control the tone of the body, and descend outside the pyramid. You know in the physiology that every muscle in the body has flexor tone to initiate or to begin flexion, and extensor tone to make extension. So the muscle has tone. This tone may be flexor muscle tone or extensor muscle tone. The extra pyramidal tracts facilitate this tone of muscle. So they are controlled or they're beginning in the brain stem. These tracts are called retrospinal, begin in the radial nucleus of the midbrain and end in the spinal cord. Tectospinal, begin in the tectum superior colliculus or the tectum of the midbrain and end in the spinal cord. Lateral vestibulospinal tract and the medial vestibulospinal tract, they originate from the vestibular nuclei of the pons and the medulla. Also medial and lateral reticulospinal tract, which are originating from the reticular formation of the pons and the medulla. And some autonomic fibers called descending autonomic tracts. Okay, I don't want to know more about this tract, only know their name and their function. Okay. For you, this discussed in the histology. You discuss the horizontal section of the midbrain. This is the midbrain formed of anteriorly the crest repari, tegmentum, and posteriorly the tectum. This is the red nucleus, which is extrapyramidal nucleus or extrapyramidal motor nucleus. The red nucleus give origin to a tract called retrospinal tract. Okay, and this is the tectum at the level of the superior colliculus, which is part of the visual pathway. Okay, superior colliculus, we mentioned it, is connected to the lateral geniculate body by the superior perichium or perichium of the lateral geniculate body. This superior colliculus, as it's part of the visual pathway, it gives origin to a tract called tectospinal. Tecto means tectum, tectospinal tract. So we have extra pyramidal tracts originating in the midbrain. This is the retrospinal and tectospinal tract. The retrospinal tract arises in the contralateral red nucleus of the midbrain, cross at the ventral tegmental decussation, and it plays a role to control flexor muscle tone. Most of the tracts control the flexor muscle tone, as we need flexion more to perform different functions. Okay? So most of the tracts control the flexor muscle tone. The only tracts that control the extensor muscle tone are those which originating in the bones. So two tracts originate in the bones, which facilitate the extensor muscle tone. This is the course of the retrospinal tract originating here in the red nucleus of the midbrain, cross to the opposite side and descend in the midline as the retrospinal tract. I don't want to know more details, only know the name of the tract, this extrapyramidal tract, originating from the lead nucleus in the midbrain, as it is extrapyramidal motor nucleus, and facilitate the flexor muscle tone only. Tectospinal tract, as we said, originates from the superior colliculus. The tectospinal tract cross in the dorsal tegmental decussation and enter into the anterior frequency of the spinal cord. This is responsible for visual spinal reflexes. As we said, the superior colliculus is part of the visual reflexes or visual pathway. So it is responsible for visual spinal reflexes through its connection with the spinal cord. Okay? These details is not important, only not originate from the superior colliculus and its function responsible for visual spinal reflexes. This is the dictum, okay, and this is the tectospinal tract, which is the opposite side and descending downward. The lateral vestibulospinal tract originating, as we said, from the vestibular nuclei, from the lateral vestibular nucleus, and it facilitates I'll control the extensor tune. Extensor tune and originate in the medulla. Again, this is the vestibular nucleus in the medulla. This is the vestibulospinal tract facilitating the extensor tune. The medial vestibulospinal tract originating from the medial longitudinal fasciculus, called medial longitudinal fasciculus, it originates in the medulla. It originates from the vestibular nucleus of the medulla. We have two types of vestibular nuclei. Vestibular nuclei of the pons, which form lateral vestibulospinal tract, and the vestibular nuclei of the medulla, which form medial vestibulospinal tract. The medial vestibulospinal tract has another famous name, which is called medial longitudinal fasciculus. Medial longitudinal fasciculus, as we said, arises from the vestibular nuclei of the medulla oblongata. It extends up to the cervical part of the spinal cord and control the flexor tones of the muscles of the neck to coordinate the eye movement. Okay. The reticulospinal tracts, they are two, one originate in the pons and the other originate in the medulla, as there is a reticular formation of the brainstem extending in the pons and the medulla. The pontine one or the pontine reticulospinal tract, this facilitates the extensor tune, while the medullary or reticulospinal tract, this facilitates the flexor tune. Okay. This is the reticulospinal tract, which originating from the reticular formation and the control, if it is pontine, controls the extensor tune. If it is medullary, it controls the flexor tune. The last one is descending autonomic tracts. These tracts originating or projecting from the sympathetic fibers or parasympathetic fibers and descend through the spinal cord, carry motor and sensory information, so-called descending autonomic tracts. More details we will discuss in physiology. This is the same. Now I talk about the pyramidal tracts and the extrapyramidal tracts. Okay, I want in anatomy to know a little about them. In the pyramidal tract, know the cortical origin of the tract, know the pathway, okay, and the completion of these will be occur in the physiology. In the extrapyramidal tract, I only want to know what are the extrapyramidal tract and what is this, their function, okay? Let's we talk about the basal ganglia. The basal ganglia, from its name, they are group of basal ganglion or nuclei present in the base of the frontal node, and so they are called basal ganglia. So what is the basal ganglia? They are subcortical nuclei, basal nuclei present near the base of the frontal lobe. They are formed of many components. The first is the caudate nucleus, lentiform nucleus, amygdaloid nucleus, and colostrum. It's we see. This is the brain or the cerebrum, okay? Here, this is the thalamus in the midline, okay? The basal ganglia lies lateral to the thalamus. They are formed of this nucleus, which is coma-shaped nucleus, this till here. This is the caudate nucleus. And this one is the lentiform nucleus. Lentiform nucleus. Okay? And this small nucleus near the temporal bowl, near the temporal bowl, is the amygdaloid nucleus or amygdala. Amygdaloid nucleus. So the basal ganglia is formed of lentiform, caudate, amygdaloid, and clostrum. This coronal section, coronal section showing the basal ganglia. This is the midline. This is the midline. This is one cortex and this is the other. This is the frontal cortex. This coronal section and the frontal cortex. Let's see. This is the brain. Okay. We make coronal section like this. Coronal section like this. We made a coronal section like this in the frontal lobe to see this, the basal ganglia. So this is the midline, okay? In the midline, this is the thalamus. This is the thalamus. The cavity of the thalamus is called the third ventricle. This is the third ventricle. As I pass here, I pass laterally, okay? This is the frontal lobe. This is the medial surface of the brain, okay? And this is the superior lateral surface identified by presence of the insula. This is the insula, and the stem of the lateral sulcus. This is the stem of the lateral sulcus, and this is the insula. Here, this is the frontal lobe, medial surface. This is the corpus callosum. Above it, this is the callosal sulcus. Above it, this is the cingulate gyrus. Cingulate sulcus and the orbital or medial orbital lobule. Okay, right. If we pass laterally from the thalamus, this is the thalamus. If we pass laterally, we find at the base of the frontal lobe group of basal nuclei. This one resembles the lens. So it's called lentiform. All of this lentiform nucleus. As we see, the lentiform nucleus formed of two parts. The lateral one is putamen. And the medial one, this two parts, is called globus pallidus. So the first part of the basal ganglia is this nucleus. It's called lentiform nucleus. It's formed of two parts, putamen, and globus pallidus. And if you look at this nucleus, you will find the striation lines like this. So it's called corpus, means body, corpus striatum means striated body. So it's called also basal ganglia or corpus striatum. Okay, here this is the caudate nucleus. So in this section, coronal section, we will see two parts of the basal ganglia, caudate nucleus and lentiform nucleus. Again, what is this? This is the corpus callosum, okay? This is the caudate nucleus. This is the lentiform nucleus. This is the thalamus, the cavity here, the third ventricle, okay? Below the thalamus, this is the hypothalamus. Above the corpus callosum here, this is the cingulate gyrus. If you sit here in the midline from the corpus callosum, this is the septum pellucidum, and this is the fornix, and we will discuss later. Again, this is the coronal section, to see the basal ganglia, the caudate nucleus, and the lentiform nucleus. The lentiform nucleus formed of lateral part called putamen, and the medial part called globus pallidus. The caudate and putamen or lentiform are called corpus striatum. Okay, look here, this is the caudate, and this is the thalamus, and this is the lentiform nucleus. Here, this fibers is white fibers, and this is called internal capsule. Okay, look at this. This is a transverse section of the brain. This transverse section beginning from the frontal lobe and end in the occipital lobe, transverse. Okay, the same as we said. This is the caudate nucleus, this is the lentiform nucleus, and this is the internal capsule. So we said that the corpus striatum is formed of caudate nucleus and the lentiform nucleus. Okay, the lentiform is formed of two parts, putamen and the globus pallidus. Putamen and the globus pallidus. The putamen and the caudate nucleus are called neostriatum, as they are involved in the function of the basal ganglia. Okay, the globus pallidus is called paleostriatum as it is firstly discovered. Okay, the remaining part, which is the amygdaloid and the colostrum, they are called archestriatum. Let's talk about the caudate nucleus. As we said, the caudate nucleus is coma-shaped or C-shaped. It has head like this. This is the head of the caudate. It fused inferiorly with the lentiform nucleus. This is the body. This is the lentiform nucleus. Its head here fused with the lentiform. This is the lentiform. The head of the caudate fused inferiorly with the lentiform. This is the body of the caudate nucleus, and this is the tail of the caudate. At the end of the tail, this is another nucleus, which is the amygdaloid nucleus. And as we said, the amygdaloid nucleus lies near the temporal pool, while the caudate lies in the frontal pool. Caudate and the lentiform lies in the base of the frontal pool. Okay. What about the lentiform? This appears in the coronal and the transverse sections of the brain. As we said before, this is the thalamus, and this is the head of the caudate. Laterally, this is the lentiform nucleus, okay? The lentiform is formed of two parts. The lateral part is the putamen, and the medial part is the globus pallidus. The white fibers here, separating the caudate and thalamus medially from the lentiform laterally, this is called internal capsule. And as we see, the internal capsule is formed of anterior limb, posterior limb, and between them the genu means knee. This is like the lower limb is reflexed up. This is the knee, anterior limb, posterior limb. So genu, anterior limb, and posterior limb. Here's the anterior limb separating the head of the caudate from the lentiform, and the posterior limb separating the thalamus from the lentiform. Okay, if we go most lateral, this is the internal capsule. This is the internal capsule. External capsule. This separating the lentiform from the colostrum. The external capsule separating the lentiform from the colostrum. Okay, outside the colostrum towards the insula, this is the external capsule, extreme capsule. To imagine, let's say we see this on the transverse section. This is the transverse section of the brain. This is what we called. This is the thalamus. This is the head of the caudate. These white fibers is the internal capsule, anterior limb, genu, and the posterior limb. Okay, this nucleus is the lentiform nucleus. If we go outside, these white fibers is called external capsule, like this. This is the lentiform, okay, this is the external capsule. This is space or white fibers, external capsule. If we go more lateral, we will find the colostrum, okay. More outside the colostrum, we will find these fibers separating the colostrum from the insular gyli. This is the insula, this is the lateral sulcus, okay? Separating the insula from the colostrum, the extreme capsule, means it more outside, the extreme capsule. So the white fibers present here, the internal capsule, the external capsule, the extreme capsule, okay? The nuclei, medially the thalamus, and the midline, and this is the caudate nucleus, Okay, more lateral, the lenti-4, more lateral here. This is the cholesterol, Okay, here near the temporal pole, we like the amygdaloid nucleus. Again, this is the lenti-4 nucleus. It is wedge-shaped, like a piece of the cake or the piece of the wedge. Okay, its apex here directed medially. It is formed of two parts. The lateral one is the putamen, and the medial one is the globus pallidus. Okay, and as we said, the putamen with the caudate are called neostriatum. Okay, what is the relations of the lentiform nucleus? Medially here, this is the internal capsule. It has anterior limb separating it from the caudate and has posterior limb separating it from the thalamus. Okay, laterally, what is this? Yes, this is the external capsule. Separating the lentiform from what? From the cholesterol. Okay, more laterally, the cholesterol is separated from the insula by the extreme capsule. Okay, inferiorly, we will find the amygdaloid nucleus and the anterior commissure. What about the cholesterol? Again, this is a transverse section of the brain. As we see here, this is the frontal pole, or this is the occipital pole. We will find here, this is the corpus callosum, and this is the part of the corpus callosum in the occipital lobe. Okay, this is the corpus callosum, and this is the corpus callosum. Here, we will find this, the caudate nucleus. This is the caudate nucleus. Okay, and immediately at the midline here, this is the thalamus, and this is the cavity, which is the third ventricle. This is a small one. Okay, what is this white fibers? This white fibers is the internal capsule formed of anterior limb separating the lentiform. This is the lentiform from, what is this? Caudate. And the posterior limb separating the lentiform from what is this? Thalamus. Okay, if we go to outside from the lentiform, we will find white fiber, which is the external capsule. If we go more outside, we will find this brown color or gray nucleus. This is the colostrum. If we go more lateral, we will find this white fibers, which is the extreme capsule. And we will go more forward. This is the insular gyroid. And this is the lateral sulcus. Okay? Again, what is the cholesterol? It is a sheet of gray matter. It lies deep to the insula, and separated from it by the extreme capsule. So the insula, the cholesterol, lies between the extreme external capsule medially and the extreme capsule laterally. The function of the cholesterol is related to the limbic system. As we said before, the limbic system is formed of multiple nuclei, groups of nuclei scattered in the brain. And these nuclei are collected by white fibers, connecting them. Okay, and the function of the limbic system is in motion, it's responsible for emotion, memory, and the part of it shared in olfaction. Okay, so the cholesterol is considered as a part of the limbic system. The last part of the basal ganglia, we said the basal ganglia formed of four nuclei. The first is the caudate nucleus. The caudate nucleus, which is C-shaped or comma-shaped nucleus, okay? The second is the lentiform nucleus formed of putamen and globus pallidus. The third is the cholesterol, which lies deep to the insula. And the fourth nucleus is the amygdala or amygdaloid nucleus, okay? This is the brain, and the cavity of the brain is called lateral ventricle. This is called lateral ventricle. We will discuss later, okay? Here lies the caudate nucleus, the head of the caudate. And the caudate continue like this as C-shaped. Head, body, tail. Okay? At the tail of the caudate lies this nucleus, which is the amygdaloid nucleus near the temporal pole. This is the temporal pole, okay? This is the amygdaloid nucleus. So the amygdaloid nucleus, it lies in the temporal loop close to the temporal pole. It lies deep to the ancus. If you remember, we said before here on the medial surface of the brain, this is the corpus callosum on the medial surface. Above the corpus callosum, there is a cingulate gyrus, okay? Cingulate gyrus continues through the isthmus to be connected to the parahippocampus, and the parahippocampus continue or end by the ancus. So the ancus appears on the inferior surface, medial to the renal gyrus, Deep to the ancus, we will find the amygdaloid nucleus. The amygdaloid nucleus and the colostrum are parts of the limbic system. Okay? The function of the basal ganglia, it is motor function. And you will discuss in the physiology its function and its lesions. Okay? What about the arterial supply of the basal ganglia? When we will discuss the arterial supply of the brain, we will talk about the internal carotid artery. This, the internal carotid artery, and will be discussed, inshallah, in a specific lecture, okay? The internal carotid artery give one important branch called anterior choroidal artery. This is the anterior choroidal artery, After that, it will be divided into two arteries. Small one, which is the anterior cerebral artery, and the continuation of the artery here is the middle cerebral artery. Again, this is the internal carotid, give important branches, the anterior choroidal, and then divide into anterior cerebral and middle cerebral. Okay? Here, the basal ganglia is formed of anterior part, and the posterior part. If we look to the transverse section, you will find the caudate and the corpus callosum formed of anterior and the posterior part. The anterior part will receive branch, this branch, from the anterior cerebral artery. This is an important branch, called medial striate artery, or artery of Hoppner. Medial striate artery of Hoppner. This is important one. This is important branch. Supplies the anterior part of the basal ganglia. The posterior part of the basal ganglia will receive branches from the middle cerebral artery called lateral striate arteries. Striate means corpus striatum. So the basal ganglia supplied by, or the corpus striatum is supplied by two arteries, artery of Hoppner or medial striate artery from the anterior cerebral and lateral striate arteries from the middle cerebral. Okay, the posterior part of the tail of the caudate and the amygdaloid, which lies in the temporal lobe, not supplied by these two arteries, but supplied by the anterior choroidal artery. So the amygdaloid and the tail of the caudate, are supplied by anterior choroidal artery. Okay, again, the blood supply of the basal ganglia, the anterior part of the corpus striatum, nucleus, caudate nucleus, and lentiform, are supplied by medial striate artery of Hoppner, and this artery arises from anterior cerebral artery. Okay, the remaining part of the corpus striatum, except the tail of the caudate, receive branches from the lateral striate artery, which originate from the middle cerebral artery. Okay, the tail of the caudate and the amygdala receive branches from the anterior choroidal artery. Next, we talk about the last objective of our lecture, which is the white fibers of the brain. As we said before, the cerebral hemisphere is formed of outer cortex, which is the gray matter, and the inner white fibers, which is the white matter of the brain. In the inner white fibers, we will find some nuclei forming the basal ganglia or the basal nuclei, like this. This is the caudate nucleus, lentiform, colostrum, okay? This is the basal nuclei. Between them, this is the white fibers of the brain. If we see to the connections which we need to connect the cortical areas, we will find three types of connection. We need them. We need to connect two cortical areas in the same cerebral hemisphere. Two cortical areas in the same cerebral hemisphere. Okay? We need to connect two cortical areas in both cerebral hemisphere, this one by this one. And also we need to connect cortical areas with subcortical areas. As we said in the pyramidal tract, we connect the cortical areas to the subcortical areas in the brainstem. Okay, so we need three types of connection. Let's see. The three types of connections are, first is commissural fibers. Commissural means across the midline. So we have commissural fibers. Commissural fibers connecting the same area in both cerebral hemispheres. For example, if I want to connect this general sensory area in the right side by general sensory area in the left side, I will connect them by commissural fibers. Commissural fibers. Okay? So commissural fibers connect the same cortical areas in both in the right and left cerebral hemispheres. Okay? The second type of fibers are projecting meaning descending downward. So we have projecting fibers connecting the cortical area with the subcortical area, either ascending or descending. Okay, it's called projecting fibers connecting the cortical with the subcortical areas. The third type one is to connect two areas in the same half. I want to connect area in the frontal lobe by area in the occipital lobe. I want to connect area in the frontal by area in the frontal. I want to connect area in the frontal by area in the temporal. But all these connections occur in the same cerebral hemisphere. I will call them association fibers. Association fibers. So we have commissural fibers, projecting fibers, and association fibers. Okay, we have three types of fibers: commissural, which cross the midline and connect the same functional cortical areas in the two cerebral hemispheres, connect the same area in the right and left cerebral hemisphere. Association connect the different areas in the same cerebral hemisphere. Projecting the fibers connecting cortical with subcortical. Cortical areas with subcortical areas. Okay? The most important example for the commissural fibers is the corpus callosum. The corpus callosum lies in the phase of the median longitudinal fissure connecting the two cerebral hemispheres together. So, the most important example for the commissural fibers is the corpus callosum. Also, we have the anterior commissure, the posterior commissure, the habenular commissure, any types of fibers connecting the same areas in the both cerebral hemisphere are called commissural fibers. Now we will talk about the corpus callosum. This is the medial surface of the cerebral hemisphere identified by what? Identified by presence of this corpus callosum. So the corpus callosum identify the medial surface of the brain. And as we said, the medial surface is separated here by the phallic cerebri and connected at the base or at the bottom of the median longitudinal fissure by the corpus callosum. If we see the corpus callosum extend in the temporal lobe, frontal lobe, parietal lobe, and occipital lobe, okay? The corpus callosum located in the floor of the median longitudinal fissure. It is located or related above to this. This is the callosal sulcus. And above the callosal sulcus, this is the cingulate. This is the cingulate gyrus connecting through its isthmus. This is the isthmus to the parahippocampus. And lastly, here's the ancus. Okay. Here, below the corpus callosum, this is a small membrane, fine membrane called septum pellucidum. Again, This is the corpus callosum related superiorly to the, yes, callosal sulcus. And the callosal sulcus contain the anterior cerebral artery. The anterior cerebral artery. Okay, so this is the callosal sulcus containing the anterior cerebral artery. Right. Below the corpus callosum, this small membrane, this membrane is called septum pellucidum. Septum pellucidum, small membrane separating the two cerebral hemispheres. This white matter or this fiber is called fornix. Fornix. Fornix is a group of fibers or white matter of the brain, okay, connecting the two cerebral hemispheres, and it is part of the limbic system. The fornix is part of the limbic system. It's part of the limbic system. If we lose the corpus callosum, this is the septum pellucidum, and this is the fornix. The fornix is the white matter and part of the limbic system. Okay? So what is the relations of the corpus callosum? Its anterior and superior aspects of the corpus callosum are in close relation to the anterior cerebral vessels. As we said, this is the callosal sulcus, and in the callosal sulcus, there is the anterior cerebral vessels. Okay? The inferior aspect is this, of the corpus callosum, give attachment to the septum pellucidum. This is the septum pellucidum. Here, this is the septum pellucidum. Okay? And also attach to the fornix posteriorly. Anteriorly the septum pellucidum, and posteriorly the fornix. Note that the corpus callosum, this, is in the hair in the lamina terminalis. This is the lamina terminalis, as we said before. And this is the anterior commissure. The anterior commissure, which is also a site of commissural fiber. This is the anterior commissure. And we discuss it in the relations of the diencephalon. This is the salamus, and this is the diencephalon. Okay? Now, what are parts of the corpus callosum? Anteriorly, as we said, anteriorly here, as we said, this is the rostrum of the corpus callosum. Okay, the rostrum continues downward with the lamina terminalis. The lamina terminalis is, I will present the anterior end of the neural tube, superior end or cranial end of the neural tube. The rostrum continues here as the genu. This is the genu. The genu continue here as the body of the corpus callosum. And posteriorly here, the splenium. So the corpus callosum formed of four bars. What are these? This, rostrum, this, genu, this, body, this, splenium of the corpus callosum. Again, the anterior part here is called rostrum. This is called the genu, trunk or body, and the posterior part is called pulp or splenium of the corpus callosum. Okay. Now, what are about the connections of the corpus callosum? As we said before, this is a transverse section of the brain. This is the frontal pole, and here's the occipital pole. Okay. This transverse section take like this. This is the brain. I will make transverse section like this. Okay, transverse section. Passing from the frontal pole to the occipital pole. So this is the frontal pole and this is the occipital pole. In the midline here, this is the corpus callosum, which contain commissural fibers. Okay, the fibers that connecting the frontal pole of one side to the frontal pole to the opposite side, these fibers are called orbital fibers or orbital surface connecting the inferior surface of the frontal pole, these fibers. Okay, the other fibers that connect are passing through the genu of the corpus callosum, and connecting the frontal lobes, these fibers are called forceps minor. So the fibers passing in the rostrum, this is the rostrum, okay, and the fiber passes through it, connecting the inferior part or the inferior surface of the frontal loop, which is the orbital fiber. These fibers are called orbital fibers, connecting this one by the other one, okay? The fibers from the genu, extending like that in the frontal loop, are called forceps minor. These fibers connecting the both sides of the brain are called forceps minor. Okay. The fibers passing here through the splenium, and radiating to the occipital lobe of both sides are called forceps major. Okay. The rest of fibers passing from the body and extended like this into the parietal lobes, fiber passing through the parietal lobes are called corona radiata. Okay. Again, this is the corpus callosum formed of rostrum, geno, body, splenium. It contains commissural fibers. The fibers that passes from the rostrum to the inferior surface of the frontal lobe, these are orbital fibers. The fibers that passes through the geno connecting the frontal lobes are called forceps minor. The fibers that passes from the splenium to the posterior lobe, to the occipital lobe here, are called forceps major. The fibers that passes from the body, this is the body, here to the parietal lobe are called corona radiata. Okay. Again, the fiber passing through the rostrum, connecting the orbital surface of the frontal lobe, these are orbital fibers. The fibers passing through the geno, interconnecting the two frontal lobes together, they are called forceps minor. The fibers connecting or extending transversely from the splenium, interconnect the occipital lobes together, they are called forceps major. And the number of fibers passing from the trunk to interconnect the parietal lobes are called corona radiata. As we said, what is this? Forceps minor. What is this? Forceps major. What is this? Corona radiata. Okay, now we complete the corpus callosum, which is the most common example for the commissural fibers. What about the arterial supply of the corpus callosum? As we said, the corpus callosum is related superiorly to the anterior cerebral artery passing in the callosal sulcus. So it receives the blood supply from the anterior cerebral artery. The splenium of the corpus callosum receives the blood supply also from the posterior cerebral artery. Let's talk about association fibers. What I mean by association fiber? They connect two cortical areas or different cortical areas in the same cerebral hemisphere. So this is one cerebral hemisphere. This is the medial surface identified by presence of the corpus callosum, which is identifies the medial surface, okay? The most examples of the association fibers. The association fibers may be short, like this, connecting two adjacent cortical areas, like this fiber connecting the sensory to the motor areas. These called short association fibers. Or the fibers may be long, connecting most of the lobes of the brain, like this fiber connecting the frontal lobe to the parietal lobe and the occipital lobe. Okay, these fibers connecting the lobes of the brain. So we have two types of association fibers. Short association fiber connecting two adjacent areas, and the long association fibers connecting different areas in more than one loop of the brain. So we have short association fiber connecting the two adjacent gyri together, and long association fibers connecting the gyri located at a distance from each other. As this is the superior longitudinal fasciculus. It's very important, superior longitudinal fasciculus connecting the frontal, parietal, and occipital lobe. And like it down, this is the inferior longitudinal fasciculus, connecting the frontal with the temporal loops. Okay. What about the third type of fibers, which is the projecting fibers? Projecting fibers, the most important example for them is the internal capsule. As we said before, most of tracts either sensory or motor tract passes through the internal capsule. Most of connection to the cortex passing is through the internal capsule. So this is the internal capsule. This is the caudate nucleus. This is the thalamus. This is the lentiform nucleus. The internal capsule is formed of five parts. This one is the anterior limb separating the caudate from the lentiform. This one is the genome, and this one is the posterior limb. The posterior limb separating the thalamus from the lentiform nucleus. Also, we have another two parts, what called sublenticular part and retrolenticular part. Sublenticular part and retrolenticular part of the internal capsule. Here, the anterior limb lies between the caudate and the lentiform, the posterior limb separating the thalamus from the lentiform, the genome, the anterior and the posterior limb of the internal capsule meet at the genome. As we said, genome means knee or pen. The retrolenticular part, this fiber passing behind the lentiform nucleus, and sublenticular part, this fiber passes below the lentiform but not medial to it. The medial fiber to the lentiform are the posterior limb. Okay. Again, this is a transverse section of the brain. This is the frontal lobe and this is the occipital lobe. These two sections are taken at different levels. Okay. The first one here, this is the internal capsule. This is the head of the caudate. This is the thalamus. And this is the Y-shaped lamina of the thalamus, as we mentioned before, the anterior group of the nuclei, the medial and lateral group of nuclei. This is the lentiform nucleus. And as we said, this is striated, so called the corpus striatum with the caudate. This is lateral one is the putamen. This medial one is the globus pallidus. This is the anterior limb of the internal capsule, separating the caudate from the lentiform, genome, and the posterior limb separating the thalamus from the lentiform. Below the thalamus here, this is the sublenticular part, and behind the thalamus and not medial to it, this is the retrolenticular part of the internal capsule. Okay? Here, this is the internal capsule at different levels. And as we said, this is the external capsule, and this is the extreme capsule, and between them here, this is the colostrum. This is the amygdaloid nucleus. I don't want to remember these fibers. It is very difficult for you, but only remember that all the ascending tracts and the ascending tracts passing through the internal capsule. And as we said, the corticospinal tract, this is the corticospinal tract passing through the posterior limb of the internal capsule. This is the superior ceramic radiation carrying the most oscillations passing through the posterior limb of the internal capsule. So all these connections or all fibers projecting from the cortex to downward or arising from downward and projecting themselves to the cortex passing through the internal capsule. What about the blood supply? The internal capsule is formed of five parts. This is the anterior limb, genome, posterior limb, retrolenticular, and sublenticular part, okay, is supplied mainly by five arteries. The most important two is the middle cerebral artery, supplying here the ventral part of the anterior limb, genome, and the posterior limb. And the anterior choroidal artery, which is supplying the retrolenticular and sublenticular part and the dorsal part of the posterior limb. Okay. The another part of the genome is supplied by branches from the posterior communicating artery, and the anterior limb is supplied by the branches from the anterior cerebral artery. Again, the blood supply of the internal capsule mainly by two parts. The anterior part, anterior limb, genu, and the posterior limb are supplied by the middle cerebral, while the sublenticular and retrolenticular parts and the posterior limb are supplied by the anterior choroidal artery. Anterior choroidal artery is branch of the internal carotid artery. Okay. This is the end of the lecture, but I want to know some points. First, the blood supply of the internal capsule. When stroke or rupture, it causes sudden sudden action, as this is the couple which connect the cortex by the subcortical area. So when the blood supply of the internal capsule ruptures, the small arteries that supplying the internal capsule originating from the middle cerebral or anterior choroidal, or either from the posterior communicating or the anterior cerebral arteries, when these arteries rupture or clotted for any reason, it will lead to sudden action, will lead to sudden paralysis or sudden aphasia if it is in the dominant hemisphere. Okay. Also, the recurrent artery of Hoffner, this is the branch of the anterior cerebral artery. This is an important branch as it supplies the anterior part of the basal ganglia and its a lesion causing facioprachial monoplegia. Okay. Now let's revise the objectives of our lectures. We talk in this lecture about the tracts, which are pyramidal tracts and extrapyramidal tracts. As I said, the tracts is collection of anatomy, physiology, and histology. So I want to know in our lecture the origin of the pyramidal tract, which originating from about 30% from the primary motor area, about 70% from the motor association area 6, and 40% from the sensory area 3, 1, 2 in the parietal lobe. Also, other lobes of the brain shared by small fibers in the formation of the pyramidal tract. Okay, its course, it descends downward in the posterior limb of the internal capsule, passing through the ventral part of the brain stem, the ventral part of the midbrain, ventral part of the bones, and the ventral part of the medulla. In the lower medulla, it crosses off the side, forming the pyramidal thecal station. Then descends in the lateral column of the spinal cord and the lateral corticospinal tract. The uncastated fiber passes through the ventral horn or near the midline, forming the anterior corticospinal tract. These fibers end in the anterior motor nuclei in the gray matter of the spinal cord. Okay. The extrapyramidal tracts, including the tracts or the fibers, control the motor activity but originate or passes in a separate course or another course rather than the pyramidal tract. And as we said, they include fibers originating from the brain stem to control the muscle tones. All of them control the flexor muscle tone except those originating from the bones. So we have two tracts originating from the midbrain, one originating from the red nucleus, so-called robrospinal, the other originates from the tectum, so-called tectospinal tract. The robrospinal tract facilitates the flexor muscle tone, and the tectospinal tract, tectum, is a visual center, so it controls the visual reflexes. The other two tracts originating from the pons and the medulla, originating from the vestibular nuclei in the pons and the reticular nuclei in the pons, are the vestibulospinal and pontine reticulospinal. Okay, and these two tracts facilitate the extensor muscle tone. The other two tracts originating in the medulla are the medullary vestibulospinal tract and the medullary reticulospinal tract, and they facilitate the flexor muscle tone. Okay, another fibers as extrapyramidal tract are the descending autonomic fibers. The second objective is the basal ganglia. We talk about the basal ganglia. We said their name comes from as they present in the base of the frontal lobe. So they are subcortical nuclei. They are formed of four nuclei, which are the caudate nucleus, lentiform nucleus, amygdaloid nucleus, and the colostrum. Which is that? The corpus striatum, as it is striated, formed of the caudate, and the lentiform. Okay? And also, the lentiform formed of two parts. The lateral one is the putamen, and the medial one is the globus pallidus. So, the putamen, and the caudate are called neostriatum, as they recently found that they perform the function of the basal ganglion. While the rest of the globus pallidus is called paleostriatum. The rest of the basal ganglia, which are the colostrum and the amygdaloid, are part of the limbic system, so they are called archistriatum,
orchestrate them. Okay? This is about the components of the basal ganglia. The relations, as we said before, the caudate nucleus is C-shaped nucleus or coma-shaped nucleus in a form of head, body, and the tail. And at the tail, there is the amygdaloid nucleus. The lentiform nucleus is related to the internal capsule, separating it medially from the head of the caudate and the thalamus, and is separated laterally from the cholesterol by the external capsule. Okay? The blood supply of the basal ganglia comes from the anterior and middle cerebral artery. Okay, the anterior cerebral artery gives the artery of Hoffner or the medial striate artery, supplying the anterior part of the lentiform and caudate, and the lateral striate artery comes from the middle cerebral, supplying the posterior part of the lentiform and caudate. The tail of the caudate and the amygdaloid receiving branches from the anterior choroidal artery. Anterior choroidal artery is branched from the internal carotid artery. Okay, the third objective or the last one is the white fibers of the cerebrum. We have three types of fibers, which are association fibers connecting two areas in the same cerebral hemisphere. If the two areas are adjacent to each other, it's called short association fibers. If the fibers are, or if the centers of the are distant from each other, they are connected by long association fibers. So we have short association fibers and long association fibers. The most important examples for the long association fiber is the superior longitudinal fasciculus connecting the frontal, parietal, and occipital lobes, and the inferior longitudinal fasciculus connecting the frontal and the temporal lobe. The word fasciculus or the word tract means a group of fibers have the same origin, termination, and the course. The word fasciculus also means many fibers having the same origin, termination, and the course, but they mostly used for small tracts or short tracts. Okay. The other type of fibers is the commissural fiber. Commissural fibers connecting the two cerebral hemispheres together, and the most important one is the corpus callosum and the anterior commissure. Corpus callosum formed of rostrum, which connects the inferior surface or the orbital surface of the frontal lobe, genu, which is connecting the frontal lobes together by the forces, minor, body, which is connecting the parietal lobes together by corona radiata, and posteriorly the splenia, which is connecting the occipital lobes together by the forces, major. Okay? The last example of the last types of fiber are the projecting fiber. The most important example for the projecting fiber are the internal capsule, And as we said, the internal capsule forms five parts: anterior limb, genu, posterior limb, sublenticular part, and retrolenticular part. These parts, each part contain types of fibers projecting up and down through it. Okay, the most important area is the posterior limb, which containing the mean ceramic radiation or the sensory ceramic radiation, and contain also the corticospinal or the pyramidal tract. Okay, the internal capsule receives blood supply from the anterior cerebral, middle cerebral, posterior communicating, anterior choroidal arteries. Okay, so the genu, anterior limb, posterior limb are supplied ventrally by the middle cerebral artery, the sublenticular, retrolenticular, and the part of the posterior limb are supplied by the anterior choroidal artery. Both part of the genu is supplied by the posterior communicating, and the anterior limb is supplied by the anterior choroidal, anterior cerebral artery. Okay, thank you, and I hope you happiness.